Pakistan, Afghanistan, and the Taliban. Pakistan is quite different, far more important to the region, the West. And the world then is Afghanistan, a statement which is matter not of sentiment but of mathematics. With more than 180 million people, Pakistan has nearly 6 times the population of Afghanistan or Iraq, twice the population of Iran, and almost 2/3 the population of the entire Arab world put together. Pakistan has a large diaspora in Britain and therefore in EU, some of whom have joined the Islamist extremists and carried out terrorist attacks against Britain. The help of the Pakistani intelligence services to Britain has been absolutely vital to identifying the links of these potential terrorists to groups and to preventing more attacks on Britain, the USA and Europe. Pakistan therefore has only been a partial ally in the war on terror, but still a vital and irreplaceable one. For we need to remember that in the end it is only legitimate Muslim governments and security services that can control terrorist plots on their soil. Western pressure may be necessary to push them in the right direction, but we need to be careful that this pressure does not become so overwhelming that it undermines or even destroys those governments by humiliating them in the eyes of their own people. Finally, Pakistan possesses nuclear weapons and one of the most powerful armies in Asia. This means that option of the US attacking Pakistan with ground forces in order to force it to put pressure on Afghan Taliban simply does not exist, as both the Pentagon and the Pakistani military have long understood. Deeply unsatisfying though this has been for the West, the only means of influencing Pakistan has been through economic incentives and threat of their withdrawal. Economic sanctions are not really a credible threat, because the economic collapse of Pakistan would play straight into the hands of the Taliban and Al-Qaeda. Pakistan's relationship with India has been central to Pakistan's behavior since 9/11. As of course it has been ever since partition and independence in 1947. Fear of India has both encouraged and limited Pakistani help to the US in Afghanistan. This fear is exaggerated, but not irrational, and neither are most of the policies which result from it. On one hand, fear of a US-Indian alliance against Pakistan seems to have been a genuine factor in Musharraf's decision to help US after 9/11, and was certainly used by him to convince the military and initially many ordinary Pakistanis of the necessity of this help. On the other hand, fear of India has both a reason and an excuse for Pakistan not to redeploy more troops from the eastern border with India to fight against the Taliban in the West. Lastly, the Pakistani establishment long cherished the hope that it could use Pakistani help against the Taliban to bargain for the US pressure on India to reach a settlement with Pakistan over Kashmir. This hope has faded with the refusal, compounded of unwillingness and inability of both the Bush and Obama administrations to play such a role. But this refusal and America's tilt towards India have added greatly to long-standing Pakistani feelings of betrayal by the US. Pakistan's help to the West against the Afghan Taliban would, however, have been limited in any case, both by strategic calculation and mass sentiment. In terms of mass sentiment, the overwhelming majority of Pakistanis, including communities from which most Pakistani soldiers are drawn, see the Afghan Taliban as engaged in a legitimate war of resistance against foreign occupation, analogous to the Mujahideen war against Soviet occupation in 1980. In terms of strategy, the Pakistani establishment approach to Afghanistan has long been driven by a mixture of fear and ambition. The fear is above all of Afghanistan under the rule of non-Pashtun nationalities becoming an Indian client state, leading to India's strategic encirclement of Pakistan. This fear has been increased by a well-founded belief that India is supporting Pakistan's Baloch nationalist rebels via Afghanistan by what seems by contrast to be a purely paranoid conviction that India is also supporting the Pakistani Taliban. The greater part of Pakistani establishment therefore believes that it needs to maintain close relationships with the Afghan Taliban since they are Pakistan's only potential allies in Afghanistan. In the recent years, belief in the need for a relationship with the Taliban has been strengthened by the growing conviction that West is going to fail in Afghanistan and will eventually withdraw, leaving anarchy and civil war behind, just as occurred after the Soviet withdrawal and fall of the communist regime from 1989 to 1982. In the resulting civil war, it is believed every regional state will have its own allies, so must Pakistan. Incidentally, it is worth pointing out that even entirely secular members of the Pakistani establishment do not see the Afghan Taliban as morally worse than the Taliban's old enemies in the Afghan Northern Alliance, leaders with whom the West has in effect been allied since 2001. Atrocities and rapes in the 1990s helped cement Pathan's support for the Taliban. They massacred Taliban prisoners and looted Western aid after the overthrow of Taliban in 2001, and their role in the heroin trade has helped destroy any hope of the West curtailing that trade since 9/11. Equally, it is important to note that in the great majority of cases, both in the elites and in the mass of the population, this sympathy or support for Afghan Taliban does not imply ideological approval or any desire that Pakistan should experience the Taliban-style revolution, any more than support for the Mujahideen in the 1980s implied much liking for them. Hence, too, the great difference in Pakistani attitudes to the Afghan and to the Pakistani Taliban. There was never a chance that Pakistani establishment and army were going to let Pakistani Taliban conquer Pakistan. The long delay in fighting them seriously was because they were not generally regarded as a serious threat to Pakistan, but were seen as local Pathan rebellion, which could be contained by a mixture of force and negotiation, because many ordinary Pakistanis, including soldiers, saw them as misguided but nonetheless decent people dedicated to helping good jihad in Afghanistan. Because there was a deep opposition to the state engaging in a Pakistani civil war for the sake of what were seen to be American interests, especially among all sections of Pakistan's Pathan population, and finally because the Pakistani military and its intelligence services were deeply entwined with jihadi groups which they had sponsored to fight against India in Kashmir, and which were in turn entwined with the Pakistani Taliban. As soon as the Pakistani Taliban were seen by the establishment to be a really serious threat to the central Pakistani state in the spring of 2009, the army, with the backing of PPP, Pakistan People's Party, led government and much of the establishment in general, took strong action to drive them back. The army's victories over Pakistani Taliban in Sawat and South Waziristan have settled the question of whether Pakistan will survive the Pakistani Taliban's assault, bearing once again an attack by the US or full-scale war with India. They have, however, settled nothing when it comes to the question of army's willingness to fight hard against the Afghan Taliban for the sake of a Western victory in Afghanistan.